2024 here in Las Vegas. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, sitting alongside my co-host and analyst, Rob Strechay. Rob, I always love hosting with you, but I especially love hosting NetApp shows because great conversations, and it's a good time.
Yeah, great people, great guests that we have lined up, and a lot of customers, too. And I think, again, some of them were brought to the main stage just a short time ago for the opening keynote with our guests that we have on now.
Well, great segue, because we have a very special guest. We are welcoming George Kurian, CEO of NetApp. Thank you so much for coming back on theCUBE, fresh from the main stage.
Thank you. Thanks so much for being here. Super excited to have you at Insight. We've got partners, customers, lots of technology proof points.
And some stilt walkers, too, that we
might see
in the background here.
Yeah.
So, George, you were just in the keynote, and you really stressed how success in business today is going to hinge on how well organizations harness the power of data and AI. You called this the era of data and intelligence. How do you define this particular moment in time that we are living through?
You know, it's been the culmination of hundreds of years of work where mankind has wanted to have data and tools that understand the data to help us better understand our behavior, you know, be able to draw insight, and also the always yearning for prediction of the future. And what we've seen over the last few years is profound improvements in the capabilities of the tools that are being used to analyze data and the ability to analyze all of the data in an enterprise. You know, usually a large enterprise, about 85 to 90% of their data is unstructured data, meaning documents and images and voice recordings and so on. Those were never integrated into the business system for analysis, and now with generative AI, you are able to do that. And so we call it the intersection of data and intelligence, and we're super excited to be part of that journey.
Yeah, I think what brought it home for me, and again, going back to the customers and the challenges they faced, you talked about, you know, where you're going, and kind of, you know, turned it over to Cesar to talk about it a little more in depth, and Krish to talk about it. And I think one of the things that was really interesting is, hey, we've talked to over hundreds of customers about this. What are some of those challenges you see they're facing, and where do you see AI being either a solution or kind of the how they get to AI through those challenges of data and that to get to that intelligence?
Yeah, maybe we can start with the challenges and then talk about what are the industries and use cases that we see progress around. You know, with regard to the challenges, the whole industry is spending a lot of time improving the algorithms, right? And so there's an enormous amount of work going on to bring the algorithms to where they are as capable as they've ever been. I think what we see is that the algorithms are only as good as the data that you feed them, and so it's super important that you have a really good data strategy and a data management approach that helps the algorithms understand your business better so that you can use it to drive business advantage. The second is very similar to cloud. AI has been implemented as a silo from an infrastructure, from a data, and from a process perspective, which is why so many of the AI projects never make it to production. And so what we're doing is, much like we did in cloud, solving the data management challenge, as well as bringing the infrastructures for AI and data together so that they can work harmoniously.
Yeah, and I think that was one of the things that Monica from J&J, who we have on tomorrow, really eloquently talked about how they need to be able to have, and you even talked about it, how do you bring the AI to the data, and
Exactly. Where
the data and the partnerships that you have with Google. You had Matt Wood from AWS, you had Satya in via video for Microsoft and Azure, and even on stage, you were talking about. And it has to has to be interesting though, because you see it across different industries and those challenges. Do you see that the challenges are similar across those industries, or are they differ slightly, or how do you see it when you look across the customer base?
In general, what has been really interesting for us to observe is that we see that those institutions that have organized their data and managed it well are well positioned for success. You know, we had several practitioners here from life sciences and pharma where the regulatory environment requires them to have consistent procedure codes and consistent privacy mechanisms and, you know, clinical data organized in a particular way with metadata and quality in a particular way, right? And so regulated industries are actually growing faster with AI than unregulated. And a lot of it is because they've had the practice of doing AI, and we had AWS confirm the same. I think with regard to what we see today in, you know, broad-based landscapes are sort of knowledge worker productivity use cases are progressing quite well. Whether that is the back office for sales, whether it's software engineering, whether it's the legal department, we're seeing good progress across both customers and in our own environments. And then where we see transformational impacts is where the data is well organized. In manufacturing around process improvements, you know, we've got, you know, kind of people improving auto manufacturing with digital twins. You know, you talk about a broad range of life sciences and drug discovery. We're seeing, for example, in, you know, the food and beverage industry, people improving the output of quality of the beverage production life cycle and so on. So there, you know, in industries where the data is well established, you're starting to see the transformative impact.
So, George, there are some leaders who say, I've seen this all before, a world-changing technology with the potential to fundamentally change the way businesses operate, the way we do our jobs, that either doesn't quite deliver on its promises or maybe takes a lot longer than people are expecting. There was a piece in the New York Times today about Jim Covella, the head of Goldman Sachs stock research, who is really bearish about AI. I'm curious to hear where you fall and how long you think these changes will in fact transform business.
You know, I think that when we think about technology transformations, we think that in the short term you may be over bullish, but in the long term you're probably less than what you should expect, right? So for example, in the era of the internet, you know, human connectivity and being used as a platform for doing business actually became really, really impactful and transformative. Amazon is the most, you know, shining example of that, but it took longer than what people expected. So I think our view is quite similar, which is maybe people think that the transformation will happen in 2 years, but actually if you look out over the long term or the medium term, over a decade, it's probably more impactful in the out years than people expect today.
Yeah, we're seeing very similar things in our research where, you know, about 50% of organizations are actually building on-premise. Very similar to how J&J talked about it, how they have some of the regulated data, they don't want to put that, that's their intellectual property. And to your point, you know, that fine-tuning or how they actually ground those models, they're not building the next llama or something like that. They're actually fine-tuning llama to do what they need, these small language models. What other things do you see that NetApp can do to help organizations really prepare for AI and get ready for that?
We are really focused on helping people get a good handle on their data, right? The first step in any AI project is to select the data, to explore your data assets, to be able to catalog them the right way, to be able to ensure that you have a good sense of whether that data is fresh or stale. That's the first. And then link it to the model universe, right? So that, yeah, as models change, you can keep track of which data sets which models use, and conversely, as data changes, you can keep track of what model outputs came from what data sets. We also believe that there will be increasing scrutiny of explainability of models and data used so that you can protect against bias or other harmful outcomes, and we're building tools for that. Of course, the advancements around securing and protecting your data so that there's no malicious use of it or poisoning of the data with false data getting injected. Those are all things that we are focused on.
One of the things you said in the keynote was that, or the one of the things I think that the audience came away with from you was this real urgency around making sure AI remains accessible. And that is going to be ever more important, especially as so many people need to upskill and reskill. So how is NetApp ensuring that, AI is accessible to, different groups of people?
Yeah, I think in two ways, right? I think one is, you know, we believe that for AI to have the transformative impact that people talk about today, that it can't just be the largest organizations, but it has to be every organization, whether it's educational institutions, whether it's governments, whether it's underdeveloped countries, all of them have to be able to access AI. And the ways that we are working on that problem is by trying to make it much simpler to use your data and to integrate AI with your operating, you know, kind of framework as a business, right? And that helps by saying you don't need specialized knowledge, you don't need specialized infrastructure, you don't need really complex ways to manage your data. By making it simpler, you can create more accessibility, and that's what we're really focused on.
Simplicity.
Yeah, I mean, and I think part of your message as well, the partnership aspect of it seems to play a big role. Now, we have also Insight and CDW coming on tomorrow as well. And it seems like, yeah, I mean, it seems pedantic to say it this way, but it takes a village to really get AI. How do you see, you know, what you're doing to really prepare organizations to really continue down that path? Because you talked about the $7 trillion of productivity, which is massive. I mean, that number actually stood out in my head when I was sitting here. How do you see kind of just your vision for helping push that down? Is that from a NetApp perspective?
Listen, I think you said it well, Rob, which is that you cannot innovate alone, right? The multiplicative power of innovation is when you do it with others. And we've always had both the quiet self-confidence as an organization that our capabilities are distinctive, but also importantly the humility to know that to really land the impact of what we're doing, that we want to do it with others. And so we've got a lot of innovation going on with, you know, players like NVIDIA and the big hyperscalers, of course, but also the smaller players in the landscape. Machine learning tool chains, you know, data quality tool chains, data security you know, vendors, so that we can build complete solutions. And when multiple companies work together to solve a problem, it usually is a better outcome for the end customer, right? Because they can take advantage of the skills and the investments they've made with others, and also benefit with the work that we're doing.
I love the words you just used, the quiet confidence, but also the deep understanding of what it takes to do innovation, to be creative, and the importance of making sure you're doing it with others. How do you make sure you are maintaining that culture to drive growth and the innovation that NetApp needs in order to help other companies stay competitive?
I think innovation is a cultural norm, not a set of practices and principles, right? It's how you bring the habits of listening with open ears and, you know, humble hearts to be able to have the trust in the organization that you can try things out, and if they don't work, it's okay. Nobody's going to penalize you. That it's okay to go explore ideas and concepts with another company because they might find ways to work with you, right? So it's a set of behaviors and practice habits that you build into the organization. And I think that what's been amazing is we've had that over our history, and you can see it even stronger today than it's ever been before.
Excellent. George?
Yeah, I mean, I think that one of the things this is that is really standing out is, again, that sense of community here. This, I mean, again, the energy is fantastic on the floor here. It was fantastic. A packed audience in there for the keynote as well, which was great. So what are the things that you think people should be listening for the rest of the week? What kind of final note on this? What should they be, you know, not specifics. I don't want to give away tomorrow morning and all the excitement out of that. We'll unpack that tomorrow, but
I think the whole idea behind NetApp Insight is that we are a community of practitioners and everybody learns from everyone else, right? It is not NetApp telling the world about NetApp. It's our customers, our partners, and everybody who we work with teaching each other. And so that's the most important thing that we are trying to foster at this conference. And so what I would tell you that we would hope our clients take away from it is there's a world of possibility out there, and we as a human race need those possibilities to happen. You know, because the challenges ahead of us, economically, demographically, environmentally, need the capabilities that we are talking about. And then that they don't feel that these are so esoteric that they can't step into it, right? Personally, professionally, organizationally, they have the courage that NetApp is giving them tools, and other people have told them how they can use those tools to build a bridge to the future.
A powerful note to end on. George, thank you so much for coming on theCUBE. It's always a delight talking to you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for being here. We're super excited and glad that you're here.
I'm Rebecca Knight for Rob Strechay. Come back tomorrow for more of our live coverage of NetApp Insight. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise technology news and analysis.